And hopefully that will be a feature of today's game as well. And I'm sure during the week, I mean, I was in Tipperary during the week down in Dundrum Hotel Golf and Leisure Club, and like the people there were a bit apprehensive. They were waiting for the Tip team to be selected. Who was going to be playing centre forward? Who was going to be playing full forward? Who was going to man the number six berth? And I'm sure it was the same in Kilkenny. And some guy was telling me he's going into Kilkenny this week. There's a big sign outside Kilkenny going in, and it says, "In God we trust, but in DJ we believe," you know. So obviously they had inside information that DJ was going to be in the starting lineup, and he's there today, and certainly they will look that he can make a big impact in this game. He's gone on number two, Thomas Castelloni. Kelly will feel there's an opportunity there for DJ maybe to come up trumps today.
Oh sure, yeah. I wish, by the way, I had a job like yours. The company seemed to just pay him to play golf all the time.
In any county.
In any county. We are speculating, by the way, about the kind of crowd we'll have today here, Chair. Obviously, eventually it'll fill out nicely, but very empty. I suppose that's really compared to yesterday here and the Dubs. I suppose it's hard to kind of match that kind of atmosphere you have when the Dubs are in town and in their home ground as such.
It is, yeah. I was talking to some of the officials down there today, and they're expecting only between 40 and 50,000. Now, there were nearly 60,000 here last year, but of course, Waterford, well, that was the first time in Croke Park in a long time in a semi-final. Extra people came from there, but Kilkenny haven't got a huge population. So they haven't got, they don't bring a massive following, but the following they bring are knowledgeable and fanatical. Now, Tip have a bigger following, so you'd expect at least 50,000 for this semi-final, but whatever number of here are here, this is going to be a real hard clash between these two teams.
A bit of traffic problems, you were saying, we reckon around as well.
Yeah, a bit of traffic problems out at Newlands Cross and up by the toll bridge. A lot of people held up there, but that was about 3 or 4 hours ago, so hopefully by the time the game starts, we won't have a repeat of what happened last night.
Oh God, please God, certainly not indeed. Well, now our commentary team for that game are Ger Canning and Cyril Farrell. Well, how do they view the big game, and who do they think that will win it? Let's find out.
Well, the crowds are still coming in here, the expected big attendance that you've been talking about there, between 40 and 50,000. And you can be sure that today, at least, the Tipperary and Kilkenny fans know when to arrive and where to arrive. And there'll be no 15 minutes late, I can promise you. Cyril is with me, as you say. There is this big gap since Kilkenny last played in the Leinster final and today. It's 6 weeks. Is this hoodoo going to happen again? It happened, as we know, to Galway. And it also happened last week to Waterford.
May not be a hoodoo jar as such, but definitely it's a big disadvantage because
one,
after
two, three,
six
four,
weeks,
five,
five six
seven,
out
nine,
of brief
ten.
Competitive hurling, and Tip have had games played. Now, Tipperary may not have played that well in the games,
but
it has been proven over the last
seven,
few weeks that those playing the games, you can't beat match practice. And even Dublin yesterday were way sharper yesterday than they were in the football quarterfinal the Sunday before. And the matches bring them on, so therefore Tip should have an advantage in the match situation.
Now, Kilkenny have felt the need to bring back in the great DJ Carey. He hasn't played for a year. Is it a wise move? I know we'll know at 5 o'clock.
Well, if they win, it's the correct move, and if they lose, we give an out about it, I suppose. But DJ is a top player. What DJ has, he has terrible presence there. Even not playing well, he's going to take watching. And any chance he gets, he'll go for a goal, not tap it over the bar. Now, Tom Costello will probably be on him, and he's going to have to be on his toes for 70, 73 minutes.
Mention of Tom Costello and his colleagues, Nicky and Tip would just love to win it again because, of course, they are the reigning champions.
Yeah, they are, and like they're kind of coming around by the back door, like losing to Waterford. They were well beaten today. It didn't seem to bother them too much. And they've Eamon Corker got in centre back now. If the Tip half back line get in top, they're going to have a great chance of winning. But Eamon will be on Henry Shefflin, and that's going to be a fantastic duel as well.
There'll be a lot of fascinating duels, Cyril, and Cyril will be joining us for commentary. And that match, of course, coming your way at 3:30, just as the sun comes out. It should be a very pleasant evening.
Yes, it was actually very wet and miserable earlier on today here in Dublin, but as Ger said there, it's picked up nicely, so we expect a fine evening for this game here. Well, you know, at the beginning of the year, Kilkenny were a popular choice by most of the experts to lift the Liam McCarthy Cup. Mind you, they were last summer as well, until they were overpowered by Galway in the semi-final. And that defeat was a setback, especially as they were the defending All-Ireland champions. So the big question is, have the Cats got the desire to make amends this year?
Championship matches are not won by doing the nice handy things or adorning the thing with little bits of maybe an odd point here and an odd point there. It's the guys who are going to win the tough ball, the hard ball, and fight their corner the whole way through, because it's tough and it's about hanging on for your dear life some stages. And at various stages of every championship game, you're going to be put to the pin of your collar to survive. And it's the fellas who won't give in, the fellas who will hang on and come back fighting. They're the fellas we look for, and they're the things we want to make sure we have every day we go out.
Pat Fox, that may seal it now. Magnificently put over the bar by Pat Fox. His fifth point of the day, and that may be as the they say, the insurance point for Tip.
It's 91 since we played Tip last, and everyone can get in Tipperary wants to see this game, and I suppose it's a massive game for both teams and their supporters. And I suppose we felt maybe back in 91 we might have left that one behind us, but we'd like to get one over on them again.
Tipperary have a great record against Kilkenny in Championship Hurling. There's no point in us pretending otherwise. The number of times Kilkenny have beaten Tipperary in Championship Hurling are very, very few, 1967. Mm. Other than that, I can't ever remember it happening. So I would say that Tipperary are happy enough that with the way their year is going, they're in the All-Ireland semi-final against ourselves. They're All-Ireland champions and they know how to win in Croke Park.
We probably know we have to improve on our last day. We didn't play that well against Wexford and we'll have to have a big improvement the next day. Well, having said that, we won't be found wanting on today, that's for sure, for effort anyway.
Wexford, we're really, really, really geared for that game. And, you know, it was a test of the delight we got, because all the questions really were asked of us in that game. And thanks be to God we came through it. But at the end of the day, you know, there's going to be more questions asked of us against Tipperary.
Over the last 3 or 4 years, they've been playing very good hurling, and Nicky has instilled a lot of belief into them down there. I think they're very strong throughout, and they seem to be very strong in depth as well. Any subs they seem to bring in seem to work on the day. I suppose it's gone that way now, where panels of 30 are there, and managers are using the five subs, and they're very strong in depth anyway.
In 2001, they are the premier county in hurling.
The All-Ireland champions, and justifiably so. They deserved everything they got last year. They won the league and the All-Ireland last year. An excellent team. They didn't win their Munster final this year, and they've had their entry to the qualifier system, and that may well be to their benefit. It'll be 6 weeks now when we play the game semi-final. It'll be 6 weeks from the time the Leinster final was played. So it's a long time to be waiting for a game. But they have the benefit of the extra few games. But they're an outstanding team. They're every bit as good as they were last year. They're, I'm sure, like all All-Ireland finalists and All-Ireland winners, they can go on and mature as a team. And I would say that they will be very, very difficult to beat.
Yeah, Tomás Mulcahy, were you surprised that they picked DJ from the start for today's game?
Yeah, certainly. I mean, I suppose the management know better than anybody else whether DJ is good enough to start today on the basis of his preparation over the last couple of weeks. Certainly, the rumour has it that he has been flying in training, he's been playing very well in club competitive matches and championship matches up to date. But, I mean, again, it's a different kettle of fish going out here in an All-Ireland semi-final, because you need, yeah, certainly for me, you need that match practice, you need that sharpness to get yourself up for a game like today. And it's a risk, certainly, but I mean, if you look at DJ's record in the past, he's always had the added pressure of having to take the frees, maybe going out to take 65s, penalties. Henry Shefflin going out to centre forward will maybe take that burden of pressure off him at the moment. I think more of the pressure is going to be on Henry today, because he is the natural free taker for Kilkenny now in the last number of matches. So it may be in a situation, he's in the corner, maybe wait around the square. If you're breaking balls off of Martin Comerford, then they could be in the back of the net. And also, I mean, he certainly wouldn't have lack in hurling ability. Whether you lack in hurling fitness is the big question.
He always seems to work nicely as well with Henry Shefflin, Ger. I know John Power would be the kind of preferred supplier, but Shefflin himself seemed to work quite well.
Well, I'm not the slightest bit surprised that DJ's on today, because I was speaking to him about 3 months ago and he was in the best physical shape of his life, carrying no weight whatsoever. The only thing he said was his appetite wasn't there for the game, you know. Now, he's had an operation since, he's back again. You can be sure that after watching that Leinster final with Wexford, when Kilkenny didn't score a goal or even threatened to score a goal, that is really what rekindled his appetite, and also the desire of the Kilkenny selectors to have him back. Yeah. Now, one thing you have to remember about DJ is he doesn't need very long to get fit or even get match fit. Most of his best games have been in earlier rounds of the championship. His sharpest displays have been in earlier rounds of the championship. And another thing is the huge influence he has on the rest of the forwards. It's a huge weight off their shoulders that he's on. And especially Henry Shefflin, who was carrying all the weight up to now.
Yeah.
I expect Henry to blossom from DJ being on today, and all the other forwards maybe as well. So put all that into the mix.
Sure.
And you could say that there was only one conclusion, that DJ would be on from the start.
Okay. Well, we'll be hearing the view from the Tipperary camp a little bit later on. But right now, let me just remind you that we always want your view on who the man of the match should be from the big live game of the afternoon, because it's your chance to pick the man of the match from the Kilkenny Tip game. The player selected as our man of the match winner from the... Very briefly reflecting on that, Tomás Mulcahy and Ger Loughnane here with me. A deserved winner as the game went on, Tomás.
Yeah, no better team in the country, Michael, to get scores when they need it, you know. And they got some...
Indeed, here come Tip. So their supporters obviously greeting them on the field. Tomás Dunn, their captain, of course, the provincial captain, and certainly last year, what a performance he put in all through the year, as indeed this man, John Carroll, has been playing very well. And Noel Morris there, of course, into the team today at right wing back. Nicky English was saying during the week that this is the biggest game that he has managed to tip through since he became the manager of the team. Now, considering that they were in the Munster final last year, the league final, and of course the All-Ireland, won them, that's a major statement.
Yeah, I mean, there's great rivalry between Tip and Kilkenny, and obviously Kilkenny are the benchmark that most teams look upon as being the artists in the game of hurling, and they have a fantastic record throughout the last number of years. And certainly Tip, on the basis of their performances at the start of the year, have slipped, there's no doubt about that. Their last two games, they haven't been as comprehensive. If you were to name their starting 15 at the start of the year, you would have picked most of the guys that played in last year's All-Ireland final would have been on that starting 15. As they went on in the championship this year, there was a bit of doubts coming into their centre half-back play. Their full-back line was being questioned, their forward line, whether was it reliant on Owen Kelly too much at this stage to get all the scores. So there's a lot of question marks about Tipperary. I think they could win this match today. If we go back and we see the performance that they gave, it's clear in the Munster Championship, I think it was their best performance to date. But it remains to be seen whether they have that desire and that hunger to do so. If Nicky thinks this is the biggest game that they're facing today, I'm certainly sure they're going to give it their all.
For sure. I mean, obviously, Gerlach Nan, they haven't become a bad team since last summer when, as I said, they cleaned up everything. And looking at them through the qualifiers, I know Tomás is saying that certain doubts have crept in about some of their players, but I mean, like, for instance, the evening against Offaly down in Portlaoise, I mean, they unravelled Offaly that day.
Yeah, they did, but you must remember that Offaly were, I'd say, one of their poorest teams ever that night.
Oh, sure,
they had 321 players playing in the forward line, and the following week they were beaten by Dublin 21. Yeah. So it was the attitude of Tipperary that night. There was a hunger and a hardness about them that wasn't there in the Munster Championship, apart from the Clare game and Limerick games. Now, I think today, the big occasion, the sight of the black and amber, that'll big interest in how those two will play today.
Yeah, but because this is where a lot of their problems was being identified.
That's where a lot of their problems have been. I mean, three defenders taken off in the All-Ireland last year, three taken off in the Munster final. Yeah. They can't have that today. They're up against the best forward line in the country. They can't let Kilkenny drag them all over the field. But they have Eddie Enright and Tommy Dunn, the two players that really laid the foundations for their victory in the All-Ireland last year back at midfield. If they play well, if they get a foothold there, then Tipperary will be halfway there. But this is going to be the game of the year.
Eamon Corcoran, we saw there a moment ago, handed the centre-back spot today, of course. Now, we have to remind ourselves again, Tomás, that 1991 is the last time that these two sides met in the Championship. So that has added the spice, I suppose, to this particular fixture here today.
Yes, I mean it's an All-Ireland semi-final, Michael. I mean, everybody, they know it's a stepping stone to an All-Ireland final. It's Tip against Kilkenny. There's huge rivalry there. And I mean, you go down to Tipper and Kilkenny this week. I mean, I hear a husband and wife. I mean, she wouldn't travel with the husband today in the car. She wanted to go her separate way. He was going with his own Kilkenny jersey. He's a Kilkenny man. Because the rivalry is so intense there, they wanted to make their own separate ways. That all adds to the occasion. And for the players on the field, it's a fantastic occasion. The day is set. There's a beautiful surface outside there. Little or no breeze, I think, Gerard, at this stage.
Very little
breeze, you know. Yeah. So it has the makings of being a fantastic game. And hopefully we'll get a very, very good game of hurling.
Well, this man has done it before. He's done it so many times for Kilkenny, one of the legends of hurling, Ger, and the question is, how many more big performances can he produce for Kilkenny? Can he do today?
Well, every day he's out there, the opposition fear him, no matter, you know, whether it's a league match or, but above all, in a championship match. And whenever there's a question about DJ, he usually answers it. Now, he had a very poor year last year. His form really dipped. He wasn't in the physical shape last year that he's in this year. I think he'll have a huge influence on today's game. And I said earlier on, a huge influence on the rest of the forwards. But the key to Kilkenny's, the change in Kilkenny this year, has been their league campaign. Cody Batty and all these new young players in during the league, he drove them on in every game as if they were championship games. And he told them that if they produce the goods, you'll be here for the championship. And that's what he has done. Richie Mullally is back in the team. Martin Comerford is in there. Derek Ling is in at midfield. And only three of the older brigade are called back. Andy Comerford, Brian McAvoy, and of course DJ himself.
Yeah.
So I think Kilkenny were lucky that meet Tip last year. They're much better prepared and the structure of that team is much better this year. So that is what makes it such a great game. Kilkenny on the up, question marks about Tip, everything.
As well, and this man will be wondering, will it be decided in Kilkenny's favour? Kilkenny manager, of course, Brian Cody there, making the final preparations out in the middle of the field. Well, Cyril Farrell has just made his way up from the sideline where he was down watching the Galway Miners and part of the setup down there, trying to advise them on what they were doing. And he's made his way up to the commentary box where he's with Ger Canning right now. And that's our commentary team for the afternoon.
It's a magnificent setting. Huge crowd once again here at Croke Park, ready to enjoy what we hope will indeed be the hurling game of the year. It's a long time since they made it an All-Ireland semi-final, 44 years. 1958 was the year. So as we take a look then on the two teams, Kilkenny, of course, the reigning Leinster champions, so often featured in the semi-final and finals. Well, Kilkenny reintroduced one very significant attacker to their line-out. The great DJ is back and raring for action. Nothing strange about the composition of the backs. Peter Barry, who was superb in the Leinster final, starts once again at centre halfback and plays in his 21st championship game for a side captained by the midfielder Andy Comerford. Well, the major change, as we say, is that left corner forward DJ Carey is back for the first time since last year's All-Ireland semi-final. He's alongside Eddie Brennan, Martin Comerford, while Henry Shapland will be expected to exert a big influence there in the number 11 jersey. So the parade gets underway. The sun is out here. Pleasant evening. Up here in the gods, in our commentary position, it's cool and it's crisp, I can tell you, because we're very much in the shadow. And Tip, we'll see them in a moment, but let's just take a look through the Kilkenny substitutes, including Charlie Carter there, number 18. And of course, Pat Tennyson, number 25, was in action earlier in the championship. He's a midfield player. Well, Tipperary are the reigning All-Ireland champions, having come through the patio door, as it were, to get back into this particular situation. 70 minutes away for a possible All-Ireland final against Clare. Well, they've been forced into making a number of interesting changes. Crucially, a dead leg has forced David Kennedy to miss the start of this match. Paul Ormond remains at left cornerback. Noel Morris plays on the right half. Eamon Corcoran is in the centre, with Tommy Dunn now being partnered by Eddie Enright in midfield. Into the forwards, Mark O'Leary starts at right half forward. John Carroll is on the 40. Eugene O'Neill wears the number 14 jersey, with Benny Dunn to his left. So a lot of experience. We've heard about the difficulties that they've had in the backs this year. And they've made some changes there, Cyril, but it would appear to be their Achilles heel. And that after going through 18 matches last year, league and championship, without a loss.
Yeah, Gerard, they look very settled. They're like on the Tipperary substitute, like they have the likes of Liam Cahill. Corbett, who most people think would be on. And, you know, like, strong bench as such. And you will find, Gerard, before the end of the 70 minutes, like, that these, a lot of these subs will be on.
Well, they can use up to five subs, as we now know. It is, and we've seen in the minor match just before this, which was an excellent contest, that both managers went through their full range of subs available to them. It's a wonderful setting, great weekend for sport, and a reminder of the man of the match number, which you can pick, Republic of Ireland. It's 1550 717114, and if you're calling us from Northern Ireland, well, there it is, 0906 614-2048. Do call us with your choice. Andy Comerford there, who once played in the championship for London, played three matches for them, and today it's Andy's 23rd appearance in the championship. The two number eights are captaining their teams, Andy and Tommy Dunn of Tipperary. It's Tommy's 30th championship game. Seemed like Tipperary won the toss, but there's not a great deal of breeze to concern ourselves about, I think, and there was no absolute indication as to where they were going to play in the opening 35 minutes. They're the greatest of rivals. We heard Michael saying a little while ago there that there will be certain people from Tip married to very fine Kilkenny people, and they might go their separate ways on this one day in the year when they meet in the championship at Croke Park. I can tell you, driving through places like Urlingford, you can see the mix of colours. It is quite magnificent. The bunting, the flags are everywhere. And you'll find approaching it into the village of Erlingford. The roads are painted up tip, but defiant Kilkenny people, they have the flags and they have their colours out in huge numbers. And it's on the boundary between the counties that you really get the atmosphere.
That's true, Ger. Today, Kilkenny people are looking for a very, very big game from Andy Comfort. Captain of the team, he hasn't been having a great season, such a Joe big one. And I suppose the same can be said by Tommy Dunn, or Tomas is known down to Tipperary, because to his high standards, the high standards have been kind of quiet this year. Midfield is a big battle. Eddie Enright teams up with Tommy Dunn for the first time this season, and Tipperary will be hoping that they're successful again with this pairing.
Agustinish, Aron Avila. Big day for Nicky, big day for Brian Cody as well. And we all remember that 1991 All-Ireland final, the last time they met in the championship in the final. And Nicky English was awarded a free down on the goal near Hill 16. Michael Cleary took it, kind of mishit it, but it went in over Michael Walsh and the rest of the Cats backs. Eadon McSeedna gets this match underway. The greatest of rivals, hoping now to provide us with a feast of good hurling. They try to get away to a good start here, Kilkenny, through Henry Shefflin. Looks really fit, really lean looking. Played away down there. Billy Larkin trying to dispossess Owen Kelly, who could be such a danger man.
Yeah, Ger, already you've seen that Brian O'Mara has gone into corner forward and Binnie Dunn has moved out wing forward. But I think Kilkenny would have been expecting that move anyway.
No great surprise there. Benny has played much of the season out at left half. Good scoring record as well. Benny, 2 goals and 10 points. And that's just for this year. Martin Comerford trying to advance inside there. Philip Maher is the fullback up against him. Dangerously inside towards DJ Carey. And it gets just a little heated. And we haven't even played a minute of the match so far. Jostling for position and early supremacy. Dickie Murphy was to have taken charge of this game, but there is a pretty well documented dispute going on in County Wexford regarding referees right now, so Eadon McSeedna steps in. And it's Andy Comerford, the captain, being called across there. Standing alongside him is DJ Carey. But the referee is stamping his authority. And he's given the yellow card to Comerford. Now, is he going to talk to anybody else? He's going to throw the ball in. Didn't take long to produce that card. Back out again it comes here towards John Carroll. In towards DJ once again, ever the danger man. And he's fouled as he takes this ball through.
You can see already, Gerard, the reaction to DJ. Every time he gets on the ball, the crowd are on their feet. Now, there's fierce pressure on him, but he does deliver under pressure, and already he has started very, very well.
It'll be Henry Shefflin to hit this one. And he strikes it sweetly between the posts and over the bar. First point of the match then for Henry Shefflin. Well, he's got a very good scoring record, scored 9 points in last year's semi-final. Hit 11 against Offaly, 7 from play. So he's in really good form. And they get it back down again there through their centre-half-back, Peter Barry. The other centre-half-back is Eamon Corcoran, filling in for David Kennedy. Kennedy is on the bench and he's wearing number 28, should he be needed. and they come up for this beaten for it this time. Tommy Dunn flashing it inside there in towards Eugene O'Neill. Picked up here by Philly Larkin. Takes the shoulder, and it was a late shoulder, and the referee isn't happy with it. And it looks like Benny Dunn is the one who's going to have the name taken.
Yeah, Jerry caught him clean. He tackled very, very late. Benny isn't that big and strong as such, and that won't take much out of Philly Larkin. But he got caught, and it's going to be another yellow card. Second one in the game.
And the referee has been busy. So a yellow card, 13. First down to come over to now Benny Dunn. Benny is the younger brother, of course, of Tommy Dunn. They play for the Greyhounds from Toomoomara. Philly Larkin's back on his feet once again. Well, Philly and his dad and granddad, 10 senior medals are in the family possession. This is it again here. He was going away. The tackle came in very late into the chest there of Philly. Dangerous ball in towards Martin Comfort this time, trying to pick it from the cloud. Philip Mars there as well for Tipperary. Good turn, but it's gone wide. The cheers were Tipperary cheers. Cheers of relief. Brian Cody, former great fullback. Brendan Cummins, footballer come hurler, knocking it away downfield towards John Carroll. Well, three against two just for a moment there. Andy Comerford is the last one to get himself off the ground. Mickey English pacing up and down the line, playing every shot with his players. Andy Comerford needs attention. Ty Crowley is the team doctor. Robbie Lodge is their physio. Bit of concern there, but he's okay. Fit to continue in midfield. John Carroll misses it. Fresh air pop the first time. Peter Barry going back. Playing at centre half back, very, very secure and safe player. That's JJ Delaney. JJ, of course, only 20 years of age, a cousin of PJ, who scored the winning goal effectively in the 1993 All Ireland final. Tommy Dunn, not such a good cut from the sideline. Might come back to him, it does. Flashes in there towards Brian O'Mara. John Carroll is pursuing it as well. Everybody's after it. Won't come up, however, for Owen Kelly. This is great, strong defensive work on the part of Noel Hickey. Towards Henry Shefflin. There too is John Hoyne, whose brother started in the minor match for Kilkenny. Paul Kelly drops it in, but not a particularly good shot. It certainly wasn't a pass. And there was no way in the world that Brian O'Mara was going to be able to contain it. So 6.5 minutes are gone. Just 1 point to show for it so far. Bit scrappy. James McGarry. Towards John Hoyne this time. Comes to Andy Comerford instead. The challenge coming in from John Carroll. Thundering forward, here is Comerford. Good vision to pick out Hoyne on the right-hand side. Will he go for a pass inside to the inside men towards DJ over Martin Comerford's head? Comes spilling back out here towards Eamon Corcoran. This is very good play, taken out by the fullback Philip Marr. Down towards Benny Dunn. Being challenged there in there the whole time by Richie Mullally. That's a great catch. Martin Comerford laying it off here. They come through brilliantly with Brian McAvoy. First shot of the game that he's had. DJ Carey putting on the pressure there on Tom Costello. Nicely out to Eamon Corcoran, the new centre half-back. John Carroll sweeping it forward, partially blocked. Derek Ling and Andy Comerford working hard in midfield towards DJ once again. Quite a lot of the ball coming down that direction. Tom Costello protesting his innocence. Shake of the head by DJ. Been a long time out of action, but he's been very much involved in club activity. his form was sufficiently good to compel the selectors to invite him back in for the last 6 weeks just to see if he could make it, and he has. Philly Larkin batting it outside here towards Richie Mullally. Pressure coming in there from Brian O'Mara. Benny Dunn's about, so too is young Owen Kelly, and he has put it brilliantly over the bar. Young man from Mullinaholm, the club that gave us John Lahey, and he's made it a point apiece.
Yeah, it's a beautiful ball here. It's a ball that could have been cleared first, but once he gets it up here, very hard angle, but left to right, this side is very, very sharp. So far, even though Kilkenny is level taken, they are taking the game to tip and forcing it.
This is towards Henry Shefflin. Brian McAvoy. Great run. McAvoy, the wing forward, has players in support outside. Eddie Brennan. And that is still in play. Amazing. Huge clearance down. Mullally fumbles. Benny Dunn is in after it. Tipperary trying to enjoy a little period of dominance in midfield. Mark O'Leary, the man who got two goals and a point in last year's All-Ireland final against Galway, on the wing this afternoon. Great clearance there by Paul Kelly. Down towards his brother. Eugene O'Neill is there as well. This is good play by Michael Kavanagh. Bank official has been stationed in Thurles. Noel Hickey. Wonderful, long, lengthy clearance. Pressure back on the Tipperary backs. Tommy Dunn. Not standing around, firing it back down towards Eugene O'Neill. About to be challenged by Noel Hickey. O'Neill, who got a goal in the All-Ireland final of 1997, has turned this opportunity into a wonderful score. Good play by the player from Capawhite.
Yeah, Ger, from a lot less play and a lot less ball, Tipperary now leading by a point. And there is a slight little breeze, and it will be fair from Kilkenny in the first half. He's under pressure here, and it's a great score by Eugene.
It'll do his confidence a great deal of good. James McGarry's puck out, going towards the left half forward position. Challenging for it over there was Noel Morris, the new wing back. Derek Ling. Huge shot. It's just gone wide. Or has it? Was it touched by Brendan Cummins, and is it a 65? I think that is the decision. Yes. Yeah,
you're right, Chair. He did go up for it. He could have let it off. He went up for it and actually touched his hands.
Two very vigilant umpires down there doing their business. Assisting Eodor Maxivna.
Now, Ger, this is an unusual for you. DJ has come out to take this 65. Unusual. He's a top free taker as such, but it's his first game, could nearly say in 12 months, county standard.
He knows what it would mean if he scores.
There's pressure on, Ger.
It's over the bar, and that is the 250th point in DJ Carey's inter-county career.
Yeah, Ger, he answered the pressure. It was a tough call. He came out, the minute was given. He jogged out and took it.
42nd championship game today, and that is a sensational record by a wonderful player. Benny Dunn angling this one across towards Owen Kelly. Eugene O'Neill is in chasing after it as well. It won't come up there for Noel Hickey. Trouble for the Kilkenny backline there. Michael Cameron is the number two. Everybody appealing for it, and in the end, the umpire, who was about a metre or so away, deciding that it went off a forward. Crowd in very good form, and whatever about the rivalry between the two teams, the two counties and so on down the years, the fans mingling, great good humour. McGarry this time varying it a little bit, going towards the right wing, batted away by Paul Kelly. John Carroll has it, down towards Brian O'Mara. A chance here, it's three against two by the goalkeeper. Spooned outside there towards Owen Kelly, trying to turn inside the cover of Philly Larkin, and again shows us what a fantastic sharpshooter he is.
Yeah, Ger, for a minute there, Ger, there was a goal on. Like, O'Mara was going down the middle, could have gone himself, or just given time. You can see him here just carrying through. It splits up for him, he's thinking himself, and just at the wrong time, the ball goes away, and Owen Kelly just quite good to get a score out of it.
I think it's because O'Mara just let the ball drop down onto the ground that he decided the wisest course of action was to spoon it outside to Kelly. Noel Morris under pressure, responding well against Brian McAvoy. They have quite a duel. Already we can see that Philly Larkin is having a duel over there with Owen Kelly. Mark O'Leary coming thundering forward, two after him. The angled shot is good. Great play.
That's a beautiful score, Jerry. Took it on the volley, but he comes right through from the right wing. Makes a solo of about 25 or 30 yards. You can see him here being tackled off the stick. Beautiful score.
Anybody who is a hurling fan will appreciate the wonderful skills we're seeing here in the senior match, just as we enjoyed in the minor match before it. Andy Comerford trying to play it into the path of Derek Ling. It comes to Noel Morris instead. Man who started out the championship in midfield. Noel Hickey having a good look up before he plants this one down towards Henry Shefflin. Shefflin not having it all his own way against Eamon Corcoran. Tip trying to shore up the middle. Tommy Dunn, one-handed forward, and that'll be Kilkenny possession.
Yeah, during the last few minutes, the Tipperary half-back line come very strong into the game. Morris, Corcoran and Paul Cady begin to stop the ball going through. No matter how good a full forward on you have, if the ball isn't going through, they're not too dangerous.
Tensive looking Brian Cody, waiting for Philly Larkin to come and strike it. Good connection towards Shefflin. But you can see he's been very well marshalled by Eamon Corcoran. Playing very, very tight on his man. That's Paul Ormond inside there. His man is Eddie Brennan. We know what pace he's got. Once again, it's the artful dodger, DJ, leaving it behind this time. Great strike. Arms in the air, saluting that one. And it is Derek Ling from Emeralds. Down in Erlingford, place we were talking about earlier on, getting the first point there. John Carroll coming through at the other end. Dangerous situation for Kilkenny. Kelly strikes it, comes back off the goalkeeper. And Kilkenny do really well here. Noel Hickey in the follow-up, and it's going to be a free out.
Defensive very well there, Gerard, but Tipperary wonder how they haven't got a goal. Opened up wide again, but fantastic save by McGarry. And that should have been in the back of the net, but it was great defending.
Just as we were admiring the action at the other end, this is what happened when Tipperary took it down there, but it was a great save from Paul Kelly. The shot by Kelly, the save by McGarry. Down the centre towards Shefflin this time. He's caught it. It's a good ball. Trying to turn now, looking for support. Derek Ling, who got that fine point a little while ago, can't take it on this occasion. It's down by Mark O'Leary into the inside forward line. They press once again through Owen Kelly. He can do nothing wrong.
He's a real artiste, sir, as such. A fantastic score.
Three Kilkenny points will be disappointed. From three shots.
Kilkenny will be disappointed, sir, because that ball could be gone up the field when Shefflin caught it, which was a beautiful score by Kelly.
McGarry again driving it down towards Shefflin, and again he catches a great ball against Corcoran, beginning to assert himself a little more. It's a second fine point by Henry Shefflin. Seems to have injured himself, and it's 5-4. Tipperary with the slightest of advantages, but Shefflin managed to get up there high against Eamon Corcoran and drove it defiantly over Brendan Cummins crossbar. Just watch the catch once again. That's twice he's done it now in the opening 17 minutes. The team doctor was on just for a few moments there while we were watching the reprise of that, just to check with Henry that he was okay. He is. Peter Barry breaking it down, but only as far as Mark O'Leary. Whistle sounds, free in for jersey tugging. So a chance for Tipperary now to put 2 points between them. And it'll be Owen Kelly who will strike this. McGarry organising his defensive formation. Nobody wants to see a slip up in that Kilkenny defence. It's high, and it's accurate. His first point at free. That's 4 points in all now for Owen Kelly. And it's 6 points to four. Tip still edging it. Great catch here by John Hoyne. They needed a little more support up there. Trying to get some decent ball in as far as Martin Comerford. Back out to Henry Shefflin. It was 45 metres out from the target. And he struck it over the bar.
Gerald, that's a great one because they worked the puck out. A nice low trajectory into John Hoyne. He caught it, fed it back into Henry and over the bar.
There's a great sense of togetherness by this Kilkenny team. So many artists in a real sense on both teams. Mark O'Leary trying to play it into space there, intended for Tommy Doyle. Comes back out again towards O'Leary, but it's stolen away by Philly Larkin. Great cornerback play. Huge one up towards Martin Comfort, leaving it behind there towards Eddie Brennan. Taking possession once again and trying to be in command of the situation, and he is. A first for Martin Comerford, brother of Andy, and it's 6 points apiece, level for the fourth time. Almost ran away from Martin Comerford, but he managed to get it back.
Yeah, Ger, every time it goes into both sets of forwards, there's a sense of excitement around the ground. Both sets of forwards seems to be very, very dangerous.
Brendan Cummins puck out. Little breeze of, if anything, supporting Tipperary in this first half. Eddie Enright about to strike this. What a great cut up towards Owen Kelly, trying to break it down. It was Eugene O'Neill had the last swipe in, and it's gone out for a 65. And Philly Larkin really is having his hands full against Owen Kelly. This is it once again here, dropping down very dangerously. Philly was on his hands and knees, but did just enough, and decided in the end the wisest course of action was to just knock it out of play and later face the consequences. It's going to be Paul Kelly who will hit this 65. And we've already seen DJ Carey point one for the opposition. Paul Kelly, left-hand side. Great accuracy. Wonderful point. And it's 7 points to six. So many great skills on view. So many fine players. The match has gathered a momentum of its own up and down the field. Henry Shefflin, three around him. Needing support, getting it from Derek Ling. 1 point already. Quick look up at the post. This time it drops short. Brendan Cummins. Pitch, of course, is longer and wider this year. The foul there was on Eddie Enright. And the referee has the notebook out. And he's going to have a word with John Carroll. Just noting his number, no yellow card. So once again, there's an opportunity for the long-range striker, Paul Kelly. Having already got 165, this is 65 and a bit. And again, same result. Great free-taking. So 2 points between them once again. Very spirited and enjoyable occasion. Noel Morris about to be put under pressure over there, and he deals with it expertly. Brian McAvoy then tried to hook him and did enough. Ger Harrington over there from Cork, one of our two linesmen on duty. The other on this side is Jerry Devlin from Armagh. JJ Delaney sweeping it in there towards the full forward. Drops down towards DJ Carey. Onto it again in a flash. John Hoyne brushed out of the way that time. DJ tries to roll it up. No space in there. Shoulders coming in, and it's won by Paul Kelly. Opting to kick. They try to get back inside there into an area where they could possibly score. Paul Kelly needs a bit of assistance. Noel Morris is back there, getting it away from Derek Ling. The long clearance is by Eddie Enright. Philly Larkin makes a great catch. Steps into trouble, and there was a high challenge there. I think it was Mark O'Leary who caught him. The VIP section, I'm sure, enjoying the game. This is it again here. Philly Larkin stepping away, first of all, from Owen Kelly, and the high challenge hurley around the neck was by Mark O'Leary. And he has got himself a yellow card for that.
Yeah, Gerard, that's three yellows now in the game, and it isn't a dirty game as such, but someone could get caught as a second and then they're gone.
Absolutely. JJ Delaney driving it in there. Huge ball in. John Holland trying to get it up there. Paul Ormond is in the gold helmet. The other man there is Eamon Corcoran. Comerford inside with Shefflin hitting it. Stopped on the line by Brendan Cummins. He's had an eventful season in hurling and in football. Andy Comerford fouled by John Carroll. John Carroll has had his number ticked earlier on in this game. Needs to be careful.
Yeah, Gerard, he knew the whistle was gone the minute he hit it back into the back of Andy.
Fresh stick handed in there to Eamon Corcoran by John Hayes. Long time support for Nicky English and other Tipperary managers. It'll be Richie Mullally who will strike this one. Oh, that's not Mullally, correction, it's Henry Shefflin. Great result. His fourth point. What a range of talent they have at their disposal when it comes to taking frees. DJ with a 65 earlier on. Henry Shefflin, two from frees, two from play. Brendan Cummins. Big one down towards Carroll. Battered it in there first time. And they're off the mark quickly. And in particular, Benny Dunn. Playing it into space here towards Eugene O'Neill, couldn't contain it. Just as Richie Mullally, the man on the green helmet, just like Shefflin at the other end. Andy Comerford towards Brian McAvoy, in beyond Noel Morris. This is Shefflin, neat pick-up, taking on Eamon Corcoran. Great pace, great penetration. He had vision as well, and he was lucky to get that ball back. It's in towards Martin Comerford. And it stopped on the line there somehow. And Eamon Corcoran in there to help. Big sigh of relief from the Tipperary followers. That could have been real danger. Shefflin just inches away from getting the first goal of this game. Tipperary have had their chance at the other end. It was Martin Comerford with the final shot. The ball almost ran away from Henry Shefflin initially, but he managed to regroup, regain, and the clearance was by Eamon Corcoran.
This time, Joe, we have DJ out the far side, just about 66 yards out from the goals.
Well, can he work the Oracle once again? Great concentration. And the umpire this time says wide. It's Tipperary's, or Kilkenny rather, third wide, two wides for Tipperary.
Wasn't far off, Gerard, but it's an unusual situation where you have kind of two free takers taking them.
Brian O'Mara beaten by Richie Mullally. Into the challenge quickly was Tommy Dunn, inside towards Eugene O'Neill, ready to take on Noel Hickey. Going this way and that, little jinky pass outside, but it reaches a Kilkenny man, Richie Mullally. Broken down by DJ Carey. Brian McAvoy's coming in there, thundering in. Spotting DJ, moving into the clear. Eddie Brennan was there as well. There's a man free and unmarked just to the right of them. That is Henry Shefflin. Never reached him. Noel Morris instead, booting it into the clear. Seized on here by Andy Comerford. Just too far with the pass on this occasion. And the shoulder there on Philip Maher deemed to be an unfair one.
Yeah, and DJ's after getting the belt off the ball. No need for that. And the referee, to be fair to Aidan Maxwell, he's caught the culprit, number four, Paul Ormond. You just don't need that in a hurling game. You'll find, Gerard, that there won't be a free out to be a throw-in.
That is what's going to happen. This is it once again here.
Watch number four, Ger. That's it.
Yeah, right into the back of
right
DJ.
Into the back.
Players will have to be careful. The referee's patience is bound to run thin eventually. And we have to emphasise the point that in spite of that dig into the back of DJ Carey, it hasn't been a dirty match. Yet we've had three. It was a little tip, I think, is what the Tipperary fans will feel. Noel Morris here in need of some attention. Dr. Gerry O'Sullivan is the medical officer with Tipperary. He's been having a steady match, Noel Morris, on Brian McAvoy.
Yeah, Gerry, he's good under the high ball, good at catching it. McAvoy's trying to break onto the ball. McAvoy would have the pace and would be very disappointed that they got a score early on.
Well, Noel Morris has gone way back in front of his own goal, leaving McAvoy free away on the left-hand side, never reaches him anyway. And this time there's a foul on DJ Carey. It's Tom Costello from Kappa White who commits the indiscretion. And it's Henry Shefflin who's going to try and hit this one, and I'm sure he'll put it over the bar. Shefflin 2 from 2 so far for frees. Can he make it 3 out of 3? Approaching a half an hour gone in the first half. He certainly can. Great work by Henry Shefflin, and the team's level once again. Level now for the fifth time. The fans enjoying the match, getting right behind both teams, placing the All-Ireland final on the 8th of September against Clare at stake. And that is over by Mark O'Leary. Second point by Mark O'Leary. This was nicely broken down here.
Just helping.
Good work.
Tip edge, just holding on to that 1 point lead the whole time. He had to hit back and get the score.
Well, that's been the secret of their success so far in the afternoon. Able to come back. Answer every one of the Kilkenny points. Philip Maher getting it down. Players looking to see where it went. It went with Peter Barry. Back in there towards Big Martin Comerford. He presents a very imposing presence in front of goal. There's his brother Andy, the captain, and that's over. Both midfielders now for Kilkenny have scored in this match. Derek Ling and Andy Comerford. So they're level once again. What a contest. Brendan Cummins, Andy Comerford going back for it. Doesn't get it, however. Instead, it is Peter Barry. Up towards Comerford, that's Martin Comerford, broken out here towards John Hoyne. Kilkenny very good at putting pressure on the Tipperary backs, but that was good play by Philip Maher. Brian O'Mara now here. Good ball in. Eugene O'Neill beaten for it, however, by Noel Hickey. Steady, commanding and assured towards Brian McAvoy. Got a stick to it, but Noel Morris with a powerful deflection. And it comes to Tommy Dunn, so good at just picking up the pieces in midfield, knocking, inviting balls down there. This is Benny Dunn, his brother. Michael Kavanagh after him. Very awkward angle. Richie Mullally. About to be challenged here is Brian O'Mara. Will he go for the score? Mullally sticking doggedly to his task. And tip forced backwards, back towards Eddie Enright. Didn't want to go back any further. But tip got absolutely nowhere. That's great defensive work in the middle of the field, essentially, by the Kilkenny players. Eamon Corcoran sending it out there to Eddie Enright. Dangerously in. Betty Dunn is beaten for it this time by Michael Kavanagh. What an assured corner back. Reaching up for it brilliantly over there was the wing back, JJ Delaney. Inside towards Eddie Brennan. Eddie putting in the challenge there on Paul Ormond. Referee's whistle has sounded, however. Interesting to see what action he'll take here, how he saw it. Everybody full of concentration. Comerford to strike this. Nicely cut up. doesn't run quite as far as they had hoped. Eamon Corcoran instead, two men after him. Henry Shefflin, one of them, the other Eddie Brennan, appeals, and it's another 65. Some furious faces there, not agreeing with Eardal Maxibna's judgment in that particular instance.
Yeah, Tip will feel hard done by there because when Paul Armand was coming to the ball, Eddie Brennan more or less went for Armand rather than the ball, and they thought it was a free out.
No free is accrued. And DJ Carey is back on the 65-metre line. Can he give Kilkenny the lead? About 2 minutes of normal time, the end of the 35, still to play. Rolls it up well. And the big cheer from the Kilkenny followers saluting DJ's second 65. Brilliantly finished. It might have been a free out for Tipperary, but it's Kilkenny who got the 65. They get the point, and they lead by one. 2 minutes of added time to be played at the end of the 35. Missed by Eugene O'Neill there. They try to get it in. Whistle sounds, and it's going to be a free in. So Nicky now waiting for his free taker, who's Owen Kelly, to hit this one. This to make it 10 points apiece. Kelly for free is one from one so far. But of course, yes, three more points from play, so four in all. Would he consider going for a goal? He's having a go. It stopped. McGarry saved it initially, and then Philly Larkin saw it come away off his leg. Tip could have been level. At the other end, here comes Brian McAvoy. Great race through the centre here. Three men after him, support arriving. Derek Ling trying to get it up on the stick. Held out momentarily, now it's Comerford. Player still in support out there. Brian McAvoy once more. Tricky angle, hitting it, but he's hit it to the left and he's put it wide.
Yeah, Jerry, he'd be very dissatisfied because that's two he's missed. He has the pace, he can cut down to the defence, should be laying it off a little bit better.
This is that effort a little while ago. It was saved by a combination of James McGarry and Philly Larkin. Disappointment for Owen Kelly, but he was brave to have a go. Philly Larkin, Kelly was after him. Is there another score before half-time? Martin Comerford would like to think so. Blocked down brilliantly there. That is Philip Maher, and it's Tom Costa who comes out after it. Out towards Noel Morris, blocked again, this time the pressure back on the Tipperary backs, and it's going to be a sideline ball. Last man to touch it was Eamon Corcoran.
Yeah, Jordan, there's real high intensity in the game, there's not that much space as such, like you're closed down straight away. McAvoy has the feet to get through, but everyone else has been closed down.
In scoring chances so far, Tip with 9 scores out of 16, Kilkenny 10 scores out of 18. Lots of chances being created. High quality match. Eamon Corcoran. Noel Morris stealing a second to get that under control. Tommy Dunn. Peter Barry rising up there to try and take this one. Misses it. It's Eugene O'Neill out about 50 metres from goal. And he has put it over the bar. Eugene O'Neill's second point. And the teams are level, approaching half-time, beautifully balanced.
Yeah, Jerry, he had to come out a very long way here, so 45 yards out, and people have said about this fella that he doesn't deliver when he's picked on the team, but he's doing it today.
Certainly.